Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, let's start. So today we are in a session computer vision and intelligent service. Thank you very much for coming to this session. So the key idea of this session is that we are building the intelligent eyes of your mobile apps. So the intelligent eyes are the cameras and on your mobile phones and the cameras and everywhere, the IP cam and on the dashboard, all those cameras. So those cameras see. So what makes those cameras intelligent is something like an intelligent service lives in the cloud. And an example of that is, for example, the intelligent service that we have put out by Microsoft Project Oxford. So so we will be focused on the computer vision aspect of that. So the first we'll have Marshall talk about the difficulty of building computer vision services and deploy them in the real world. The second, we'll have Zhenyu Zhang talk about the research is related to image understanding. So the key of intelligent eye is not just see it, but also understand what's happening. So so that Zhenyu will cover the work in research in Redmond and Cambridge labs in that area. And finally, we have Tao Mei from MSR Asia. He will talk about Project Oxford and also some of the work he's working on now. So first, Marshall.
Thank you. As was mentioned a number of times since this morning, we've been making rapid progress in computer vision, both for object detection, semantic labeling, scene understanding, most recently using deep learning techniques, getting higher and higher performance for those types of vision tasks. But that's not what I'm interested in talking about today. I'm not interested in talking about research in computer vision. What I'm interested in talking about is how to use all of those wonderful results into actual system. And what are the challenges in doing that? So let me give you a couple of examples of what I'm talking about. This is one example from a project with AI, where we give directives to a robot. Those are directives in natural language. Things that sound very simple, you know, like turn right after the second building. That sounds like a really dumb thing to ask for. But if you think about what's involved there, the robot, of course, has to understand what a building is. It has to be able to find buildings in images. It has to relate that to the natural language directives and so forth. This is another example here of this kind of experiment. So you need some semantic labeling like this on which you make a decision as to how to control the thing. You have only partial views. You need to infer the structure of the environment from your partial image interpretation and all this. Now, one characteristic of this kind of application is that it's a fully autonomous operation, meaning that any decision that you make based on the computer vision input will drive entirely the success of the mission. Another way to say it is that any mistake in the computer vision output may have catastrophic results that can be unrecoverable. This is very different from other applications of computer vision, like image retrieval, for example, where some mistakes, a few mistakes, are not that important as long as, on average, the performance is acceptable. This is another example of what I'm talking about, and this was mentioned this morning as well. By the way, this morning you saw the Microsoft drone. This is university drone. You can see the difference here. Okay. So this is a view from this drone flying through a very cluttered environment. Okay. This is a very dense forest. The signal at the bottom indicates the left-right turn, indicates the control input to the system. So this is basically what the system sees from a monocular camera, and this is the control that is applied. So there again, you have a fully autonomous application. The vision system, and it's very unforgiven to the vision system. Okay. So the basic question is, we got those nice vision algorithms that everybody has been talking about since this morning. Okay, you got your application, and I showed you just two examples here and there, and there are many other applications like this. And then the question is, what do we need in between so that even though those vision algorithms are, of limited performance, they make mistakes, they are unreliable on some data, how can we still use those algorithms in applications that rely critically on the vision output? And in particular, applications in which decisions are made at every input based on the vision output. So what I'm going to do is to walk through a few things that I think need to be done for those vision algorithms to be used in those applications. Of course, this is just a sample of some of the things that need to be done. So the first one is to view the vision output a little bit differently than what we view it normally. The simple view of a system would be something like this. We get some visual input, we perform some algorithm, and we get one output, which is viewed as being the interpretation of the environment. So for example, the semantic composition of the scene or the 3D reconstruction of the scene, and that's basically the interpretation of the environment. The problem with that, of course, is that even if we attach some uncertainty to this interpretation, some probability distribution, as soon as there is an error here, because it's a purely pipeline kind of thing, this is going to affect everything that is going on downstream. And basically, any error at that level can have catastrophic results. So instead, what we really need to do is to replace that by saying, well, the purpose of vision is not to give us the representation of the environment. The purpose of vision is simply to give us a number of plausible hypotheses as to what the environment is. And then we can keep those hypotheses, reason about them downstream, and I'll give you a couple of examples of how we can do this. Now, there's a lot of work on this, of course, and all the work boils down to this kind of thing. We have a space of interpretation. It can be the space of all possible semantic labeling of the scene. It can be the space of all possible 3D reconstruction. For each possible interpretation, we have a score. It could be the output of some CRF or the output of some other algorithm. And what we're trying to do is to find both likely hypotheses, so things that have high scores, but of course, if we try to sample only likely hypotheses, we're going to end up with things that are very similar to each other, right? If I take my best semantic labeling of the scene, the next best one is going to be something very close. So what we need to do also is to have diverse hypotheses, that is, find multiple explanations of the environment that are sufficiently diverse to cover all the possible plausible explanation of the environment. And of course, we need to do that under the condition that we cannot, of course, enumerate all the possible interpretations. This is a combinatorially large space. So we need to have a way to somehow sample those hypotheses without traversing the entire space. So there's generally two broad ways of doing that. The first one is at training time, to reweight the training samples iteratively so that once we have trained the system to give us the best interpretation, we then reweight the samples given higher weights to those training samples that are not explained correctly with the first version of the algorithm, and then iterate that process to get more and more samples. The second way of doing this is to augment our original algorithm by a criterion that says, in the second trial, I want to find an hypothesis that is far from the hypothesis that I generated the first time. Those are basically the two broad approaches that exist in the literature. So if we do this, this is an example on a semantic labeling task. We have input images on the left, and instead of outputting a single interpretation of the environment, which is really, really hard, okay, we now output multiple interpretations that are the most plausible interpretation, and again, diverse interpretation, meaning that they are different interpretations of the environment. So now, even though this task as a vision task is really hard, we have a chance to be able to deal with multiple interpretation that will capture the correct representation of the environment. This is another example. This is again from the drone example. So remember this flying through the woods, right? Now, the traditional way of approaching this problem would be to say, well, from this current image or this current stream of images, I'm going to reconstruct a representation of the environment, let's say to simplify a 3D representation of the environment. And then, given that 3D representation, I'm going to evaluate a set of trajectories, those guys here near that little plane here, against that 3D representation. Now, the thing that is wrong with this is that as soon as there is one error, or the wrong type of error in that 3D estimation, the entire system is going to fail, and in this case, of the flying drone is going to fail probably catastrophically. So the alternative is to say, well, instead of trying so hard to have a single correct representation, why don't we try to have multiple plausible representations, perhaps with different likelihood for each of those representations, and combine them, use that combined set of hypotheses to evaluate our trajectories. Okay? So the important thing here is that conceptually we go away from computer vision as being a way to generate a single understanding, a single interpretation of the environment, to computer vision as a way to generate a set of plausible interpretation. So does that make a difference? Yes, it makes a tremendous difference. This is actual experiments with flying the thing in a very dense environment. The left bar here shows the distance travel or average distance travel for this particular experimental setup using a single world, so a single interpretation. And the blue bar indicate the average distance travel using now those multiple interpretations. And of course, we do much, much better using this. Okay, so that's one thing that we need to do. Another thing that we need to do is to get away from this view of computer vision as being a black box that will always produce an answer. In other words, no matter what input we have, we're going to produce an answer, an interpretation of the environment. So let me illustrate that point on one example. So again, this is an example from that semantic navigation task that I showed you earlier. And this is illustrating the fact that, of course, depending on the quality of the input, you're going to have output that can be correct or can be completely wrong, depending on the quality of the input. In this case, those are simple cases where we have overexposed, underexposed images, and so forth. Now, what is the problem with this? Again, that sounds like a trivial observation. Of course, sometimes we have bad images. The problem is when you're looking at an autonomous system like this that has to make a decision on every input, as soon as you have a corrupted input like this, it's going to produce an invalid output, and it's going to lead to basically a chain of events to a possibly catastrophic failure. By the way, this technical report from ARL is a formal evaluation of this semantic labeling algorithm in the context of semantic navigation. It's basically 100 pages explaining all the ways in which the algorithm fails. Okay, it's a very humbling experience. Okay. So what can we do about this? Well, the fundamental problem, so the previous problem was that we forced computer vision to give a single answer, single interpretation. This is what the world is, okay? So that was the first problem. This problem is that we force computer vision to always give an answer, okay? When in fact, in many cases, it cannot give an answer. So what can we do about this? Well, this is work with David Perrick, by the way, which was published last year at CVPR. One way to mitigate this is to say, well, what we need is to be able to look at the input and guess whether I could make a reliable decision based on that input. Okay? To take a trivial example, if I look at my image and my image is complete noise, obviously I'm not going to be able to make a sensible decision based on that input. Now, of course, this is a stupid example. In a real example, we have a real image, but we need to guess whether we can make a sensible decision or not. So the way this can be done, and again, I don't know the right way of doing this. This is just one way to look at it. One could imagine computing features, a large set of features over the entire input image, train a regressor that's going to predict something about the accuracy of the algorithm. Now, of course, this doesn't tell you much if you're looking at a binary task, like a simple binary classification task, but for structure prediction, like semantic labeling, then this gives you basically the information as to whether you may get a reliable result or not as as output. So this is the kind of thing that it does. This is just a little bit of a contrived example. On a semantic labeling task, this is using the Shimonchescu algorithm from a few years back. Doesn't matter which one it is, but what it does is to figure out for this algorithm, for this particular algorithm, the images on the left are going to be very hard to segment, and the result is going to be generally unreliable. And the images on the right are going to be easy to segment, and the result is going to be much more reliable. Okay? And it conforms to what you would want such an algorithm to produce. The important thing is that this is trained relative to the particular algorithm that is used for this task. Coming back to my robotic task, the images on the left are going to be unreliable for this algorithm. The images on the right are going to be more reliable for this algorithm. So now you can get a handle on the problem on the question of should I make a decision based on this input, okay? And in fact, you can now have a much more flexible system in which you can drop input. You don't have to rely entirely on the computer vision input. This is all of this is, by the way, directly related to something that was mentioned in Janet Wynne's introduction on reliable CPS systems and so forth, okay? Basically, how to integrate vision in those systems. Okay, so we want to produce multiple representation. We want to be able to not produce an output and not make a decision based on input. But everything that I've talked about so far produces a representation only based on the input. In other words, only based on the pixels. Right? Now, of course, this is a stupid thing to do because in reality, we have a lot of information. And so what we need to do is to be able to use all the available knowledge at our disposal to generate the final representation. Now, there are many names for this, of course, using context. I think Alex Bird used the term situated perception and so forth. And they all kind of mean the same, okay? We have our basic algorithm, typically a statistical learning type of algorithm, how to incorporate in that prior knowledge that we have about the task and so forth. Now, prior knowledge can mean very different things. It can mean things like approximate maps. Okay, if when you're talking about robotic application, we know something generally about the environment in which we are, except in some contrived scenario about kidnapping robots and things like that, we know something about our environment. It can be some higher level contextual information. It can be common sense knowledge about the environment and so forth. Let me show you just two quick, very quick examples. This is something using the Kili data set where we want to do adaptation to segment out different regions in the scene. This is again for robotic application, for example, detecting the road region. Now, in doing this, we could do this directly from the pixels, as I showed so far, or we could say that, well, we have some approximate information in terms of the environment, namely some approximate map information, and use that information to help us do the job. This is another example of this with more complete semantic labeling. Now, of course, this is still relatively precise external information, right, in terms of maps, even if they are approximate maps, and we need to figure out how to merge that approximate knowledge. Another type of external information has to do with some information about the structure of the environment. So this is an example here from another task where we want to basically give a query image on the left. We want to find images that are likely to come from the same environment. Now, this is not exact image matching. This is not the same. Those are not the same scenes, and they're certainly not from the same viewpoint, but they are from similar environment. What makes them from the similar environment is that they have the same style. You can see on those matches, they have the same style of texture, decoration, and so forth. So how can we do this? Well, the idea is basically given an image like this. We can view this image as being composed of two things, the 3D structure, the orientation of the surfaces in that image, and those, what I call here style elements, which are basically pieces of textures that are pasted on those surfaces. So if I can separate the two, now I can do image matching based on those style elements to find things that are of the same style and presumably from the same source. So this is again the idea of separating the two 3D structure and style. Now, how do I find those star elements? How can I define those things? Well, that's going to be really, really hard in the absence of any other information. I could do that from exactly labeled data from 3D, but otherwise it's going to be very difficult. The way that can be done is by using a minimum of domain knowledge. In this case, the domain knowledge simply says that because we're, we're looking at indoor scenes, we have three dominant directions, and just, and we don't need to know which ones they are. Just the fact that there are three dominant directions is enough knowledge to be able to automatically extract from unsupervised, unlabeled data those style elements. And those are examples of style elements on their detection. And those are, again, other examples of style elements. This is from the Scene 100 data set, I think is the right name for it. So basically, the point of this is that we can use additional knowledge from fairly precise knowledge about prior maps, all the way to much more, much looser domain knowledge. For example, in this case, the structure of scenes. Finally, the last—I think it's the last one—the last example has to do with what I call here task-adapted loss function. This is—I use the term loss function here. The term objective function was used many times before today in various various talks. And let me illustrate what I mean with this example here. Okay, those are two outputs of semantic labeling, those two different versions of the same algorithm on the same input image. Now, the bottom part here, the bottom result, is obviously much worse than the top one. It's much worse because this, oh, you cannot see this here. Okay. All right. Oh, wow, that's a laser pointer. Yeah, right here. It's much worse because this part here is mistakenly labeled as shrub, whether it should be building. Okay. So this is a simple example where obviously the top result is much better than the bottom one. Okay, everybody would agree with that, especially based on the typical loss function, the typical objective function that we use to train those kind of algorithm. That loss function says that I'm going to favor algorithm that that correctly label the largest percentage of pixels. So the objective is to maximize the number of pixels that are correctly labeled. That's basically what we all do in semantic labeling. Okay. Now, what is wrong with this? Well, there's a number of things that are wrong with this. First of all, in an actual application, I typically do not need to label every pixel correctly. In fact, it's completely useless to label every pixel correctly. So what that means is that I'm going to spend a lot of time optimizing a vision algorithm for an objective that has strictly nothing to do with the task. And in fact, because I do that, I may have lower performance of the overall system than I would if I were optimizing a simpler objective function. In other words, by using such an objective function, such a loss function, I am making the problem much, much harder than it needs to be for the actual task. Okay. So the question is, and I don't have an answer, by the way, the question is how to define a loss function or objective function or metric, you use whatever word you want, that is actually adapted to the task and that will do basically the minimum amount of work that is needed on the vision side to perform the task. So again, in my semantic navigation example, well, you know, to be able to turn right after the second building and that kind of thing, do I really need to have a complete semantic labeling of the image? Well, probably not. But what do I need? What is the minimum representation, the minimum amount of information I need to extract from the image? So I don't know how to answer those questions. And I think this particular problem, by the way, is the central problem in being able to transfer the state-of-the-art vision algorithm to actual application. Let me give you very quickly, because I'm running out of time. Oh, yeah. So there are ways to do this, by the way. There's an entire body of work that is very successful, which looks at learning vision system for grasping. All right? So you have a robot that grasps things forever, right? I mean, forever. Many times, right? And you basically have a binary task. Either it's successful or it's not, grasping the thing. And you can now imagine learning an entire end-to-end system, right, that will learn end-to-end something with the objective function or the loss function. You penalize if you don't grasp, and you reward if you grasp. So that's possible, and there's been recent work that has shown that very successfully. But then if you go to a task like this, what do? Okay, we cannot generate 10,000 examples of that task. Okay, and even if we could, how exactly do I measure the output? Okay, so there's basically an open problem on how to match what the vision system does to the actual task. This is one example. This is a work with Deepita Day and Drew Bagnall, again on this flying thing. Okay, so the naive view or the most immediate view of that problem, we have this input sequence of images on the left. We reconstruct the 3D from that sequence of images. That's the thing in the middle. Green is further, red is closer. And then we evaluate trajectories with respect to that 3D reconstruction, and everything is fine. Okay, that would be the general idea. Except it's not fine at all, because the objective that we're optimizing in doing this is to try to recover 3D reconstruction is as accurate as possible. So it's basically like a pixel-wise error, right? And we're trying to get the depth as accurate as possible at each pixel. But I really don't care about that. The only thing I care about is that my trajectories are evaluated correctly. Basically, I care that I don't collide into an actual object. Okay, so what we try to do is to change the algorithm so that the evaluation now is not how accurate the 3D is. Okay, the evaluation is, do I collide when I shoot or not? And the other advantage of this is that, coming back to my earlier comment, that in many cases the vision system itself is going to give a corrupted output, we can identify those corrupted outputs. Those are two examples in which the 3D map here is completely wrong, and it's completely wrong because of various effects that on the orientation of the robot and so forth that I cannot get into. The interesting thing is that we can now automatically identify that this is wrong by looking at the trajectory evaluation directly. In other words, not looking at the 3D evaluation, but looking at what matters for the task, that is being able to evaluate those trajectories. So for example, this allows us to implement a behavior where whenever the system detects those conditions, it enters in a different mode where it hovers, takes additional images and so forth to try to correct the situation. But this could not be done if we were viewing the problem as purely a 3D estimation problem followed by a trajectory evaluation. Okay, so this is, and I know somebody's nervous in the back and he's waving at me, so this is the last slide. Okay, so this is a kind of a set of a few examples of things that we need to look at that are not the vision algorithm themselves, the core of the vision algorithm, but those are things that we need to look at as to how to use those vision algorithms. There are many more of those, being able to do anytime prediction, being able to adapt the algorithm from small sample. This was mentioned already this morning, I think, this small sample training and so forth. So that's basically all I wanted to talk about today. Thank you.
We actually have some time for questions, so. Please remember that the Q&A will be recorded. So we are doing recording.
Be careful.
We are doing recording.
What you ask, is that what you're saying?
No, that's not it. It's just want to let you know. So
a lot of pressure. My question is it possible, for you or for some people to learn features in the image to see whether that area is important or not, because for certain applications, certainly some area is important as you indicated, but maybe it's possible to use those maybe from a data set to get in those areas and somehow to learn those patterns, and just so that those features are associated to the purpose of those applications.
Yeah. So in principle, it would be possible. So from the kind of thing I showed for the input filtering, if you look back at what the training does. It basically learns which features are predictive of performance. So in principle, if those features are specially sensitive, you could go back and figure out which part is important or not. So in this case, we didn't do that. I mean, there might be other work that does that, but in principle, that would be possible.
I think we have time for.
Yeah, you said the questions were recorded. That's why nobody wants to ask questions now. You know?
Yeah, task-based loss is an interesting idea, but you know, in order to do so, you have to characterize task and how to do it.
Yes, so by the way, I need to mention that Katsushi published in 95, I think, a paper called Task-Oriented Vision, which I recommend everybody looks at, okay? So that is a problem. So that's why I was saying, for the grasping operation, again, there's some great work going on there, because in that case, you can really, I mean, it's a very simple it's a complicated problem, but it's a very simple loss function that you can characterize. When it goes to those more complicated tasks or more structured tasks, then there is a problem as to how to formalize that. And as I said, I don't know how to do it certainly, and so that to me is a very important area of work. Until we do this, we're going to separately develop our vision algorithm. We're going to improve their performance on curated data set, okay? But we will never know whether what we're doing here is actually relevant to a particular task. So even though, unfortunately, I don't know how to do it, I think this is a critical area.
Thanks. So I think that's all our questions. So we'll move on to the next speaker. At the end of the session, hopefully we'll have more chances for you to ask more questions.
Still recording.
Oh, yes. The recording is, it's just a fact. There's no censorship.
Good afternoon. Welcome to Microsoft. I'm Zheng Yuzhan. I'm a research manager and a principal researcher at Microsoft. So it's my pleasure to give my talk after my academic brother, Marcel. Actually, we have never given a talk together in the same session, so it's a pleasure. I'm going to talk about multiple research projects on computer vision conducted at Microsoft Research in Redmond and also in Cambridge. And as Marcel said earlier, computer vision has made a tremendous progress. One example is deep learning work. This is a work done by Jensen, the team at MSRA. Their work on the deep learning system on the ImageNet shows that the result can beat human performance, okay, for the 1,000 object categories. And we have, multiple implementations, like on the CPU, on GPU, as well as on the FPGA. That's 10 times faster than the implementation on the CPU version. But obviously, there are quite a lot of mistakes made by the computer. For this example, like letter openers, it's very trivial for human. But for computer, they made various change mistakes. So computer vision still falls far short of what we can do with human vision. And there are multiple reasons why it's so hard, because there's a huge varieties of sources contribute to the formation of an image. And here, just a few examples of the image variability, like a scene type. In this particular case, it's a street scene. And you have a different scene geometry. And you have a different categories of objects. you have the the objects are located different places and with different orientation, as well as the different shapes. So there are many, many like depths, occlusions, appearance difference. So for this car, you can see there are different colors, and as well as the different illuminations and the shadows. So it's a hard problem. The good news is if we constrain the condition environment, then a lot of interesting problems can be solved. Okay, and here in this particular case, I will talk about collaborative office space. Okay, I will focus on this scenario. So in the collaborative office space, there is a large shared space for people to work together. That's a whiteboard. And because this shared space is large, people can focus their attention toward the same area. So it's very effective to make it productive. But the more and more in the offices, we have large interactive whiteboard, as well as a massive number of displays in the office. And Microsoft has announced recently the device called Surface Hub. We have two versions, 55 inches and 84 inches. And imagine in the near future, our walls will be covered by this large interactive displays. How can we make it more productive? So here we propose to add computer vision technology to make it more effective by adding a kinect sensor next to the display, the Surface Hub. By combining this a large touch board and the RGBD sensor, the interaction can be more natural and the collaboration with remote people can be more immersive. So here, the project called VBot, it consists of two sub-projects. The first one is called VTouch. This will go beyond touch by understanding the people in front of the touch board. The second one is called ImmerseBot for remote collaboration. By using the depth sensor, we can see the remote people in a very natural and as well as immersive ways. So people will feel share the same space, they have the gaze awareness, etc. So I will talk about this more later. First, let's look at the VTouch project. The key technology used is the sensor display calibration, human skeletal tracking, hand gesture recognition, person recognition. I won't go into details because of lack of time. And there are a number of things we can do with that system. I will show you a video later. So for example, we can bring up a menu without touch. We can display the menu wherever you are. And we can augment touch with hand ID, person ID, gesture ID. And we can bring back hover capabilities, pointing, and also like lock the display content for privacy. So before showing the video, just a few screenshots to illustrate the system. For example, if I need to change the color of the pen, if we use the old normal system, you have to go to find the start menu, bring the option for the color. Now, if you just show the open palm, the menu will come out, and you can change immediately the color. If you want to type somewhere, you just show these two hands, palm open, two hands, then the soft keyboard will come immediately. Okay, so the menu will come out where you want to. The second one is the person ID. Because if you just use a touch, you don't know who is writing on it. But with computer vision, we know who is the person writing. So then you can have the natural interaction between multiple people on the whiteboard, and we know who wrote what. And this screenshot shows that when there's nobody in front of the display, it will be automatically locked. But after, if you come back, and if you were the participant of that session, then it will be unlocked automatically for you to continue the collaboration. We have the gesture recognition, pointing, and we recognize whether you point with the left hand or right hand. And for writing, we know whether you are writing with the left hand or right hand or with a pen. And you know, with the touch, the hover is lost. But now, with the computer vision, you know whether the hand is approaching to the screen or not. So we bring back the hover, and the context menu will come out to change color, make the text bigger or smaller. And the menu will follow you wherever you go. Imagine you have the 84 inches or even in the future 100 inches display. It will be convenient to have the menu always next to you. So now let me show you the short video.
VTouch is a novel system that uses computer vision to enhance touch interaction on a large, touch-sensitive display. Thanks to a Kinect pointed across the display, VTouch can understand where the user is, who the user is, and what the user is doing even before the user touches the display. Gestures, such as an open palm, may bring up a color palette, from which the left hand may select erase, the pen may select green, and the right hand may select red. These selections are remembered. Erase with the left hand, write green with the pen, and write red with the right hand. Another gesture, a pair of high fives, opens a keyboard, making it easy to enter text anywhere on the screen. Hovering over the text brings up a menu of attributes, which may be selected to change the color or size of the text. Different users can also be distinguished using vision. Another user may select his own color and stroke width. When the first user returns, his settings are remembered. The strokes and text are tagged as belonging to user 1 or user 2. VTouch knows the user's location. Not only can it bring up a menu near the user, but it can keep the menu near the user, so he does not have to hike back to the far end of a large display. Pointing, for interaction when the user is away from the board, is also possible. Pointer gesture detection is robust against other gestures. The right hand is distinguished from the left. Selection is also possible. VTouch requires the Kinect to be calibrated with the display, but calibration is easy, simply by touching 4 points on the board. VTouch uses vision to enhance touch by detecting gestures whether far or near to the screen, distinguishing between hands when they touch the screen, restoring hover to touch screens, distinguishing between users, and tracking their positions. VTouch, vision-enhanced interaction for large touch displays.
And we have conducted a user study on the different features we have implemented, and most of the features are preferred by the user. And next, I will talk about this vision-enhanced immersive remote collaboration. So we want to use the Surface Hub for people to collaborate across distance. But before that, let's look at what we do when people are co-located. So when people are co-located in front of the physical whiteboard, they share the same space. They can see the face of the other person, the eye gaze, the intention, the gesture, etc. So they know how the content is created in a rich way. But if we look at the current remote collaboration systems, usually you have the workspace. And you have a window for the remote person on the face, showing the face. So
between the two parties, there is very little information shared by the two parties. Okay, you see only the face. You don't see the gestures, etc. And in terms of content, you see only the content created. You don't know how the content was created and where it will be created. So you don't know. So what we want to do now with this system, we want to make it much more immersive. So you see the reference point of the remote person. You feel you share the same space, and you are aware of the gaze from remote people. And you can predict the intention. And with two metaphors to implement this immersive board system. The first is two people standing side by side in front of the whiteboard. Okay. The second one is two people standing in front of a mirror, and you look at the remote person through mirror rather than to side. So you can have the glass wall effect. And here are a few conditions we have implemented. The top left is just a setup, and top right shows almost exactly the same system as the current video conference system. But now we extend a hand from the box of the person to where the person will write. Okay, the stretch arm. And on the bottom right, we represent the board as a tilt inside and put the remote person next to the board. And you can have the right ideas. And for the bottom right, left, we have the mirror mode. You see the person behind the screen. And now let me show you the video.
For remote collaboration through an electronic whiteboard with immersive forms of video, thanks to a Kinect camera mounted on the side of a large touch display, we augment shared writing with important social cues, almost as if participants were in the same room.
So
this 2.5D hybrid between standard 2D video and full 3D immersion shows the remote participant's 2D video on the side, but his hand is able to extend out of the video frame in a non-physical way to write or to point to a place on the shared writing surface. This visualization shows the remote participant in full 3D, as if the participants were standing shoulder to shoulder in front of a physical whiteboard. Eye gaze direction is improved, as well as gesture direction, body proximity, and overall sense of presence. The participants are able to look at each other to check for understanding. Finally, this visualization shows the remote participant in 3D as if reflected in a mirror on which the participants are writing. Eye contact and gaze direction are further improved, as well as overall sense of presence. Immerseboard makes remote collaboration almost as good as being there. Natural remote collaboration.
So what I just showed you is a project called VBOT. By adding Kinect sensor, we make the system much more natural because it knows who is in front of the large display and what gestures, how far it is, etc. And also make people feel they share the same space with remote people. So in the next few minutes, I will mention a few projects from Microsoft Research Cambridge. The first project I want to mention is done by Jamie Shelton and his colleagues about effective shape and pose inference from depth images. Here is a diagram flow of the system. First, it detects the hand, and then extracts the region of interest. And through random forest, they do the initialization as well as hand pose optimization. And here is a short video.
We present a real-time system for tracking the continuous articulated motions of a user's hand with only a commodity depth camera. Our system can reconstruct the complex articulated pose of the hand whilst being robust to tracking failure and supporting flexible setups such as tracking at long distances without over-constraining the user to close-range forward-facing scenarios. Our system offers new levels of robustness and flexibility for interactive applications.
This enables the full dexterity of our hands to be leveraged in interactive applications, as the one shown here. The flexibility of our tracker is key and enables new interactive possibilities, as we demonstrate later in this video.
Here we show a wide range of poses that our tracking algorithm can reconstruct. Notice that our system can deal with fast motions and can recover from tracking loss. It can also track. We present a real-time system.
Okay, the next video, short video, will show the comparison with the leap motion system. You see, sometimes the leap motion fail to track the hand, and his tracker can do much better. Okay, so the final project I want to show you is done by Pushmit. Also from Microsoft Research Cambridge. It tried to understand the reality using depth sensor to generate credible augmentation. The first one is about labeling point clouds. So the on left is just a standard depth image with textures. On the right, you see different colors indicate different categories of objects using random forests. And he can also complete partial views of depth sensor using domain knowledge, like what Marshall shared earlier. You know, in this environment, you know it's three walls with signatures, so you can complete the floor, for example. And the third one is a semantic labeling through voxel conditional random forest. And in order to manipulate, you need to know whether the objects, how the objects interact with each other. In this case, if you try to remove the book, then you see, oh, there's a cup on top of it. So it reasons that you cannot do that. And the last one is a dynamic capture and labeling at the same time. Here is a short video. And the color also indicated different categories of objects. And it can be done in real time. OK, I think I will stop here. Thank you for your attention.
Check. So. Again, we have some time for questions. More? Okay.
Okay.
No, we don't have any questions. So, okay, let's move on to the next speaker. We and all the speakers will be around to ask. You can ask questions later at the end of the session. So next one, we have Tao Mei to talk about Project Oxford and also some of the technologies that he's working on and video to sentence.
Hello everyone, I'm Tao Mei from Microsoft Research Asia, and in this talk I will talk about our recent work on video analysis. And this is a joint work with a very large team that we call the video analytics team across multiple groups in MSRA. And in particular, I will talk about how we can provide some video API working with Project Oxford, including the video to language and highlight detection and video classification. And you can see from the screenshot, we're trying to understand the video contents and we are trying to provide a natural sentence to describe the video contents. If you attended the previous session for vision to language, you know a little about the image caption. So we will talk about the video caption. So before we started, so I'm wondering how many of you have heard about the Project Oxford. So the Microsoft Project Oxford is actually a portfolio of the REST APIs and the SDKs, which can help the developer to easily add intelligent capabilities such as the language understanding, speech recognition, face detection, image understanding into the their applications. So these APIs let the developers to leverage the power of the Microsoft deep learning investment in this field across the different platform. And through the Project Oxford APIs, so the developer can easily write a very simple piece of code to integrate their the simple APIs to their applications. And actually, we have the Project Oxford was released in this April in Microsoft Build events, and we have four categories of those APIs, including the Vision API, Face API, Speech API, and the Language Understanding API. So for the Vision API, we have several modules, like image analysis, like we can classify the objects in the images, and we can also extract the OCR characters from the images, and we can also generate the thumbnails. For example, we can detect the salient region from the images, and we can do smart cropping if you display the images in different devices with different resolutions. And for the face API, we can actually detect the face area, and we can detect some attributes like the age. In China, we call it yanzhi. And also, we can recognize the gender of the face, and we can also do face grouping and face identification. And for speech API, we have the speech recognition, text-to-speech, speech intent recognition, etc. And also, we have a bunch of the APIs for language understanding. So at Microsoft Research Asia, we're also working with our product teams to trying to provide some video APIs to the third party or to the developers. So for example, we're trying to provide the video summarization. For example, we're trying to provide to extract the keyframes from the video. We're trying to provide the motion thumbnails to summarize the video contents. And we can also stabilize the video on the fly. And we can also detect the motions from the surveillance video. And also in this talk, I will particularly talk about the video analysis talk. And by providing the video APIs, we're trying to cover the functionality across the action camera and also the surveillance camera, the ranging from the surveillance video to home video to the consumer video captured by the GoPro cam or any action cam. So the first project is the video to language. So as we know, video to language is a grand challenge in the area of vision and multimedia. So previous research and predominantly focused on recognizing the individual concept. And many applications we have for video to language, for example, we can teach the robotics to understand the scene. And also we can provide the movie description for the visual impaired people. And we can also turning the video surveillance to incident reports. And also by learning the pairwise relationship between the video and the language, we can do better embedding, which can be used for video indexing. And let's recap the image caption competition. So in this year's CBPR, we have five papers accepted to the CBPR about the image caption. And the competition is very emerging in this area. And we can see that all the papers are published in the past 6 months. And also we can see a lot of company and a lot of university are involved in this competition. And how does the image caption work? So if we want to understand how does video caption, video to sentence work, so we can start from the image so that we can get a better background. So Actually, we can classify the image to caption works into two categories. The first category is the using the language model to generate a sentence. So for example, the MSR works, they follow the pipeline of the detecting the words from the images by multiple instance learning. And then they can generate the sentence by using some language model like a maximum entropy. And finally, after they generate multiple sentences, they can do sentence re-ranking by employing the deep embedding. So this is the pipeline for using the language model. And the other line of the research on image capturing is to use recurrent neural networks, which can consist of two steps. The first step is to learn the visual representation by deep neural networks, like, for example, the convolutional neural networks. One can use the AlexNet or VGGNet or GoogleNet. While the second step is to generate the sentence using the RNN as a powerful sequence learning method. So you can see that in the first step, learning the image representation, we can use a different neural networks with different layers. And in the second step, so we have multiple choices to input the visual descriptor. One is that we can input the visual features from the first step at the first time to the RNN model. Now the other choice is that we can actually input the visual features at every time. So this is most teams doing this. But yeah. Unfortunately, there's no evidence which one is better, but keeping the features input at every time seems to involve some overfitting problem. And we have the many challenges for video to sentence. Video to sentence is still under explore. And because learning video representation is very complex compared with the image representation. So we have to deal with the visual objects in the video content. Also, we need to deal with the temporal dynamics, like a motion, optimal flow in the video stream. And also, probably we need to consider about the audio information. And also, we have to deal with the more complex neural network structure. For example, we can deploy the 2D convolution neural networks to video frames, or we can design some 3D filters to perform the convolution neural networks. And also, we are trying to deal with the sequence learning versus the static frame learning, and which corresponding to the pooling and alignment during the learning. And also, we need to deal with the semantic relationship between the entire sentence and the video contents. And how does the video to sentence work? So similar to the image caption, we can also categorize the video to sentence into two categories. So the first category is the language model, language template-based model. So this is very similar to image caption conducted in MSR in the Microsoft Research. So the first step is to try to predict the best words to describe the triplets, like subject, verb, and object. So this is like a video classification task. And the second step is to generate the sentence using some language templates. So for example, if we can recognize the SVO triplets, so we can actually compose the sentence using some factor graph model. The second approach is very similar to the image caption. So we can employ the RNN to generate the sentence from the video stream. And you can see that we have multiple choices to learn the video representation, right? So the first one is that we can use the 2D 2D CNN to extract the visual representation from the video frame. And also we can generate the optimal flow images so that we can use the 2D CNN to extract the video presentation from the optimal flow images. And also we can employ both the 2D CNN and 3D CNN for learning the video representation. And also we have multiple choices to learn the video for the RNN learning. The first feature, the first choice is we can input the visual feature as the first time, And the second one is that we can actually input the feature as every time to the CN. And also we have the third choice, which we call the mean or soft attention for the pooling. Because video has multiple frames, so the different frames may contribute differently to the overall sentence generation. So some research team from the, I think it's from the University of Montreal, they proposed the soft attention to detect which key frames contribute to the final sentence generation, which shows a very impressive performance. So here our work is the joint learning of the embedding and translating. So there are two key issues in the video sentence generation. One is the relevance, which means the relationship between the sentence semantics and the video contents. So which means the subject, verb, and objects in the sentence should be consistent with the video contents. The other is the coherence, which means the sentence should be coherent in terms of the grammar. So here we have some example. So the LSTM is the traditional method for generating the video sentence. And the LSTM embedding is our method. You can see that using the embedding, so we can achieve better performance because we not only care about the sentence coherence, but we also care about the relevance of the each words in the sentence to the video contents. So we propose the joint learning of the relevance and coherence for better video to sentence generation. And here is the overall framework for our LSTM embedding work. So we have three components. So the first one is the joint 2D and 3D deep convolution neural networks for learning the video representation, which corresponding to the left up part. And the second one is the deep RNN for generating the sentence, so which corresponding to the right down part. And also we have the joint embedding model to enforce the relationship between the video content and sentence semantics. So you can see that if we have the joint learning about the relevance and the coherence. So, and if we don't care about the joint learning, so the whole process is very traditional, like many other teams did. So here the difference is that we care about both the relevance and the coherence learning, so that in the learning process, we are trying to learn a better representation of a better embedding TS and TV, and also we are trying to learn the best parameters in each LSTM unit. And this is what we are trying to learn, the video representation using the 2D and the 3D convolution. And we evaluate, the data set we evaluate is the YouTube to text data set, which was originally collected by Microsoft researchers and finally released by some professors in the Berkeley. And we have only, 1,900 YouTube video, and each video is corresponding to the 10 or 15 seconds. And for each video, we have around 40 human-generated sentences. I think it's from the collected by Amazon Mechanic Turk. And the dictionary is rather small. So after removing the similar words and doing some duplicate detection, we only have 7,000 words, which corresponding to 45 subjects, 200 verbs, and 240 objects. So the training time is actually, for all these videos, is actually 12 hours in one single CPU. And the testing time is very fast, it's less than 5 seconds per video clip. So the figure shows the some ground truth and testing, some training and the testing data. So you can see we have a multiple sentence per video. And this is our roadmap. So I think starting from the last October, so the University of Austin started this problem. And then research group from Berkeley, Sunny Buffalo, and the University of Montreal follow this competition. And we started this project in the late January, and in the March we achieved the performance about 39 in terms of the blue at 4, and in this May we released the newest performance, which is to date the best performance in this task. And we actually look into the small video data set. So we look into the video duration distribution. So most of the video actually are from the ranging from the 6 to 15 seconds. And if we look at the performance along the different duration, we cannot see the differences of the performance along different durations. But the preferred video duration should be from the 10 seconds to 30 seconds. And this is some example within the data set. So the last line LSTM embedding is actually our method. So you can see that we can actually achieve the better performance than the traditional LSTM. And also our results is very similar to the human annotations. And here is some testing example out of the box. So we just randomly get some videos from the YouTube, and then we test the our sentence generation on this video. You can see the results is very reasonable. And actually we're trying to investigate if we just extract the keyframe from video, and then we input the keyframe into the image caption. So what result we can get? So we can see that the right side is the image to sentence results for different video frames. You can see that the results from the image caption are reasonable, but they are good at capturing the visual concept, but our work is good at modeling the action of the video. So you can see that we can recognize the dancing action, but the image to sentence work, they cannot recognize any correct events from the keyframe. Some other example, and you can see that we can, using the video representation, we can recognize the writing motorcycle events, but from the image to sentence, we can hardly generate the sentence like riding a bicycle. Okay, this is for video to sentence. And also I would like to introduce work on video highlight detection. So you can see that we can, given the video captured by the GoPro cam, so we can actually detect the video highlight on the fly. So the curve corresponding to the highlight score of the video. So we can actually display the video corresponding to the highlights segment as a lower playing speed. So, and we can speed up the display in the non-highlight segments. And this is another example captured by the GoPro cam. So this is the most highlighted segment from the video. So we can actually using the lower playing mode for this video segments. And finally, I would like to introduce the video classification API. So we can actually have a different category of the video. So for example, for the sports video, 1 million sports video released by the Feifei from the Stanford University, we have nearly 500 categories for 1 million videos. And actually we can classify the video clips into different category. And this is some example, also captured by the GoPro cam. So we can actually recognize the top three actions from the video. So most of the categories corresponding to the sports events. But we can actually generalize the method to different video categories. This is the motocross. Okay. And actually, this work has achieved the rank 2 competition in the CVPR 2015. We are ranked number 2 in this competition. And by providing the video API to the Oxford, so we are trying to provide the third party or developer the capability to deal with the video. Okay, that's all of my talk. Yeah.
Well, we
have plenty of time for questions.
I have a quick question. For the video highlighting, how do you, in something like that, how do you verify that it's the correct portion to highlight? Is that through user annotation? What should be the highlighted part?
Yeah. So actually, we have a user annotation of the highlight. Yeah. So for example, we deployed the highlight detection task in the Mechanical Turk. So we asked the users to label how the degree of the highlights they consider. And actually, we used the deep ranking to compute the pairwise relationship between the not highlight and highlight segments.
Oh, related to that, you know, can you characterize why that is highlight?
Why is highlight?
Yeah.
Right. So, actually, the highlight detection is not a new topic. So, I think that a few years ago, we regard the highlights as the video segment with the best visual quality, with the most rich semantic within the video contents, and also with the most stable camera motion, right? And this year so actually this highlight actually annotated by the users. So we just learned the pairwise relationship between the highlight and non-highlight. So from our observation, I think the most highlight segments corresponding to the video segment with the clear objects and also with the very significant motion from the objects. So this is what we regard as the highlight, yeah. Because we leverage the 2D and the 3D convolutional neural networks to learn the video presentation. So by using the 2D CNN, we can learn the visual appearance from the video. By using the 3D, we can learn the motion. So this is a kind of combination between the combination from the motion and the object. Yeah.
And then, you know, apparently human is recognized a brief stop, which is corresponding to music beat. And in fact, you know, when we repeat the same action to the robot,
yeah,
you know, key point is exactly repeated, but you know, interval is arbitrary, but human is not recognized. Meaning even though a human is observing entire sequence,
human is only pay attention particular moment. And in dance case, that key pose is a point where human is pay attention and interval, they are not attending. They are not paying attention. So I want to really want, where is that key point in this particular video? That is the reason why I ask. Anyway.
Yeah, I would say the video highlight detection is very subjective. So I think in different domain, we may have different approaches to video highlight detection. For example, for the dancing, I think the most important is the motion. It's the body motion. So we can do body tracking of the dancing behavior. And for the sports, I think the most important is the motion of the objects and also the appearance of the objects. And I think that for sports video, we have sports video analysis for the, I think in the last decades. So for the particular sports like soccer, like baseball, we can actually employ different signal like pitch view or a goal to detect the highlights for different domains. Yeah. Again, this is.
Extract the meaning of highlight where CNN is detected.
You mean the meaning of the highlight, definition of highlight?
Yeah.
Still quite subjective. We define the highlights as the moment that the people pay much attention, pay more attention on the segments.
Yes, so meaning of pay
attention. Yeah.
I think the meaning of the highlight, so some of the work that Tao presented, video classification, they can detect the action, what's happening in the video. So that's a meaning, that in that way it's related. It's not, doesn't exactly answer your question, but it's related, the closely related, yeah.
Yeah, maybe we can recognize some actions from the video and we can compute the confidence score of the actions, so we can use those scores to estimate highlight. Yeah.
Okay, I have one question. First, very good work. Thank you very much. So I'm really interested in the video embedding and the joint learning of the video and the sentence. So I have a question about the slides. Can you go back to the slides?
Yeah.
So by the way, let's not just restrict your question to the last speakers. You can ask question for the first two speakers too. So okay, go ahead.
Yeah. So my first question is that I remember in another paper, probably from the second translation paper in Google, they basically said the last hidden layer in the STM can be viewed as an embedding of the whole sentence.
Yeah, yeah.
But in this case, actually, you start with the sentence embedding. Have you tried use the last hidden layer of your STM instead of use the beginning of the?
Yeah, it's a very good question. So we can output the last layer of the STM as the feature and as the embedding. So actually, we are working with some product team for using this representation for video search. Yeah, yeah.
But in this case, actually, so what is your model for the sentence embedding from S to TS? Is a multi-layer, is a convolution net, or is another RN? I mean, basically the
yeah, I think the
box.
We can. So actually, we can. You can see that from the we have two mappings, right? Mm-hmm. So one is the using the TV for the video embedding. The other is for the TS for sentence embedding.
Right.
So I think either I think we can use the use the video embedding to compute the video representation.
Yeah, so my understanding is that for the video embedding, you get a sequence of CNN, and then you get a sequence of vectors. Then you combine them in probably using another network to get a single vector for video.
Yeah.
So for text, where the vector come from? For example, your input is like a man is riding a motorcycle. Then you go to the sentence embedding.
Yeah.
So do you have a network in the between?
No. So for the sentence embedding, I think the feature could be coming from the any deep learning representation, or we can use a very simple like a TF-IDF representation.
I see.
Yeah, it's the original representation of the S is the very high dimension.
I see. So TS, how many dimension for TS?
TS is we can embed the sentence from the maybe 10,000 dimension to the maybe 500 dimension.
I see.
Yeah.
So basically, S is like a 10,000 dimension vector, and TS is like 500.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. TS and the TV transform the different high dimension into the same low dimension space.
I see.
Yeah.
And in your results, you compare the STM and the STM dash E. The difference is using this embedding, using this relevance in your object function or not.
That's using the both. Both of the relevance and the coherence term in the learning.
That's for E. That's for the STM.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Great.
Which
thank you very much.
Which yields a better performance than using the each one independently.
I see. Yeah. Good. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Yeah. More questions, particularly questions for the previous two speakers.
Don't be shy.
They're afraid it's being recorded.
Big stop. Okay, I have a question for the previous speaker about the V-Hub project. Very excellent work. I was wondering, when we try to recognize user to log in the session, we focus on the face features, or we leverage all the features from the whole body, and do we need to like record the people in advance to do the offline training first to do this kind of login thing based on people recognition?
Yeah, so in our work, we use you combine the face detection recognition and the body appearance. Because you know when you walk in front of the display, sometimes you turn around, right? Or you another person is in front of is between the camera and the other person, so you have to make it very robust in terms of the person recognition, and the body appearance actually is very robust during the session because you don't change clothes, for example, during the session, but the face may not be visible from the camera. So we combine both, and we have multiple appearance model. So it's upper body, lower body, with different orientation for the human body. Yeah.
Thanks, Castro, for asking so many questions.
Yeah, in terms of fairness, I should ask to Zhenyu, and you know there is a theory called uncanny valley, and if you use a human figure to something, that action should be quite similar to the human, or else you know you feel some uncomfortable. And in your demonstration of the something, you know, side by side, human's hand extended, right? Uh-huh. And you know, instead of using human, how about to animation? The reason is, maybe that kind of situation may provide uncomfortableness to the other guy due to the uncanny valley.
That's a very good question. So we have not, we have multiple projects. One is with avatar, it's not a photorealistic model. And for this one, we just reproduce the human appearance as much as possible. For this particular one, when you walk in front of the display, actually you don't feel uncomfortable. After a while, you pay attention more on the action rather than appearance. But currently, we are trying to see whether non-photorealistic model is better or not. So we are working on this called the shadow hand, etc.
Just to follow up on that, when you did that experiment, you had three options, right? It was the mirror. Then there was like a tilted view plus this one.
Yeah.
So was there a preference? I'm just curious.
So people prefer different
there was no
different configuration for different scenarios.
Different tasks.
So for example, for the first one, the video is the best. The stretch arm. So the human, the video quality for the human is the best because there's no change in terms of the views, right? But the arm is stretched in a non-physical way. If people prefer high quality, that's best. For the tilt board, the gaze is very good because we manipulate the 3D one. So you have the real gaze awareness and the gesture. For the third one, currently we use only one Kinect. So we rotate so much for the mirror mode. So you see mostly half of the person. So visual quality is the worst. In terms of the gaze awareness, people feel the best because you don't need to turn your head to the other person. You just look at the screen. So it's hard to say which one is the best. I think the best is to give the user choices. Depending on the scenario, like for the second one, the tilt board, for the presentation, people like it very much. For the mirror mode, when you have intensive collaboration with the remote person, that's probably the best. You have less, turn in terms of head motion.
Okay, let's give a round of applause for all the speakers for the excellent presentation. Thank you for the participation.